out for the Lord. Come on. Amen. God is good. All the time, the Lord is good. I want to thank you for your prayers and patience with me while I'm on vacation. And it looks like the closer I march toward that study Jordan, I'm more apt to say I'm on vacation. Because I need just a little time to reflect and to replenish myself. Can you say amen?
Amen.
You know, thank God that you love me, but you know, I sure need some time off, amen. And y'all probably get tired of me anyhow. That's all right. Amen. That's all right. Amen. I do love you. Amen. And let me express my love for you now. I thank God for the privilege of pastoring these many years, a church that has been loving and gracious to me and to my family. Can you say amen? You certainly have blessed me tremendously. For that, I am so grateful. All of your love that you have shown toward me down through the years, I have so many memories already in these 12 years as they are progressing as a pastor, and I am blessed from God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I want to salute the class of 71. Heavenly Word. Amen. Amen. Thank you for gracing us with your presence.
Amen.
I want to thank God for you and how far he has brought you.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
Amen. We know that he didn't have to do it. Amen. But he did. And for that, we all ought to be grateful. Can you say amen? Now, with both of those captions in mind, God's graciousness to me in the class of 71, I want to look at a text that I preached last year. Reflectively, Romans chapter 8. Really started the series and stopped because of different occasions and things that were running. And I've never done this before, but I think I'm going to be in two series. I got a couple of pieces I want to do on money. Just in reference to what we've already talked about in terms of money. But today, I want to reinitiate or recommence this series on spiritual maturity. Might I say, much of what will come out of spiritual maturity is what we believe and know about God, what God will do as a believer, what you believe and know. Because what you see does not always reflect what God is going to do. Your situation may not even look like what God, but God can change it in the midnight hour. Yes, he can. He can change it in 24 hours. He can change it in the twinkling of an eye. He has a track record for changing things like that. So a lot of times what we're facing, what we're seeing, you've got to remember that God is in control. That he is in control. Amen?
Amen.
So I want to remind you today that the Lord is ultimately in control. Amen?
Amen.
And I don't think I'm going to be long, but if I am, it'll be the Spirit of God. Romans chapter, we're going to pray about this mic. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. I'll read down to verse 30. The gospel. Romans is considered a gospel, the fifth gospel by theologians. If all the Bible was lost, what one book would you want to retain? in all of Scripture, it would be the book of Romans. That's what most theologians would contend. Amen. That you have so much within it. That's something for you to just tuck away. Verse 26. Likewise, which is a transition, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercessions, stands in the gap for us with groanings. And most people think that's tongues. That's not tongues. With groanings which cannot be uttered. They're unutterable. Now, he says, he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is. That's God. Because he makes intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. It's where we'll hang our hat. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined. He knew you before you knew yourself. He already has designed, already has mapped it out, to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. And whom he called, these he also justified. We're on our way to heaven. And whom he justified, these he also what?
Glorified.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Father, we ask that you would just so anoint our hearts that we might hear what the Spirit is trying to say. Again, as we reflectively look at this series on spiritual maturity, we ask that you would mature us as believers who humbly come to you to want to be just like your son. It is your plan. It is your purpose. It's what you've already predetermined, that we be made in the image of Christ. We say, God, work on us. We know that you're not through with us. Forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. God, we just ask that the Spirit of God would fill us, that we might be able to live and do what is pleasing in your eyesight. Touch now all of our hearts. Anoint the preacher. Anoint the hearers, that we might hear your word. In Jesus' name, hide me behind yonder's cross. May you be lifted up and glorified in this moment. Everything else does not matter. What matters is your name is lifted up and that you are glorified. Bless now in Jesus' name. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
I want to talk about the overruling providence of God, that God is in control. No matter what you see, no matter what you are confronted with, the overruling providence of God. This verse interpreted in its context can bring unlimited comfort and joyfulness in times of testing and trial. With the mature believer, as with Paul, it should be a matter of profound convictions And we know that all things work together for good for them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. No room for questioning here. No room for quarreling with the circumstances. We can blush with almost a polite attitude as to say, he would or will work it out for my good, whatever it may be. He had Paul, that is, unwavering confidence in the overruling providence of God, that God is ultimately in control. He believed that God makes everything turn out for our best. For him, his convictions had rendered complaining unthinkable, since every event of life was either planned or permitted by the Almighty God. The key to the interpretation of this central statement of the context of verse 28 is all things work together for good. That is, it must be neither isolated from its context or divorced from the two conditional clauses that there are in the text. That is, to them that love God and to them that are called according to his purpose. These two clauses determine and limits its application. The simple fact is that all things do not, without qualification, work together for good for everybody. Nor does this verse claim that they do. Two things are presupposed: that there must be first a correct relationship to them that love God, not to them whose love is lacking, or to them who have left their first love. But to them that love God, all things are working together for the good. The second is, there must be a partnership to them that are called according to his purpose. That God's going to work his purpose out in my life. He's going to work his purpose out in your life. That no one or nobody can prevent God from doing what he intends to do in my life and what he intends to do in your life. And if you reach that conclusion, then you can agree with this. When these coexist, accidents are not accidental. And adversity is not adverse, because all things work together for the good. The believer joyfully embraces adversity and sorrow, knowing that all things, no matter what they are, no matter how adverse they are working for my highest good. That God is behind the scene and architecting everything, no matter how perplexed it may look, no matter how disturbing it may look, no matter how it may frustrate me, God is working it out for my good. Are you with me here? And if I can come to that conclusion, if I can agree with that conclusion, if I can come to that place, then I can understand what verse 28 is trying to say to me. Yes, the first thing that I see in verse 28 about God's plan is beneficial. God's plan is beneficial. There's going to be some benefit for me. All things work together for good. If you keep that in your spirit, no matter where you are, all things work together for good. The crux of the problem involves the practical application of this verse lies in our interpretation of the two words for good. The good promised by God in the broad range of his love may not always seem good or acceptable to us. It can seem disastrous at times. If the good is viewed in a materialistic possessions or temporal gain, because sometimes you got to ask yourself, God, this pink slip in my hand does not seem to be working for my good. She walking out on me, or he walking out on me, does not seem to be working for my good. My body going through certain things does not seem to be working for my good. I've got an eviction notice. It does not seem to be working for my good. My money is funny. It doesn't seem to be. working for my good. The good promised by God is spiritual rather than temporal. That affects us no matter what our earthly possessions may be. It took years before we could see this good and the providence of God in the life of Job. Even though it was the malicious intent of Satan to turn Job's faith away from God by stripping him of all of his earthly possessions, God still worked it out. His constant faith in God was rewarded after subsequent events. And I'm saying to you that sometimes it looks like you're being knocked down, but you're being knocked forward. Sometimes it looks like you're set back, but you're being set up. Sometimes it looks like things are not going your way, but God is taking you through the scenic route. God wants you to experience some things in life, and then God's going to show you how it works out for your good. He emerged, and so can you emerge from your trials, not impoverished, but enriched. And sometimes God will take you through some things, but he's trying to make you better. It works out for your good. The good that God has for us is higher than all the creature comforts of life. It cannot be equated with comfort or limited to our success or pleasures. The good that Paul has in mind is found in the context of the passage to be conformed to the very image of his son. Anything that does not make you like Christ is not good for you. And everything that makes you more like Jesus is good for you. And so God is doing everything to make you just like his son. Second thing that I see in God's plan is God's plan is active. All things work together. I said all things work together. The heart that loves God discerns him actively at work. And even the most heartbreaking and unwelcoming happenings of our lives, God is working it out for our good. When we look at the life of Ruth and Naomi going back to Jerusalem, God was working it out for their good. Broke and bitter, now traveling back to Jerusalem or back to the house of Bethlehem, God worked it out for their good. Because before they got there, he had a Boaz ready to be betrothed to Ruth, this beautiful girl, because God was working it out for their good. As a matter of fact, by the time they went broke, Boaz was already there. And sometimes when you're going through what you're going through, God already has a ram in the bush working it out for your good. Are you with me here? All things turn out for our best because God is at work in them, turning our blight into blessings, turning our tragedy into triumph, turning our drama into deliverance, turning our midnight into day. God knows how to work it out for our good. How God works is not always clear at times. Seems like he's doing nothing. And at that time, it seems like God is doing nothing. He's doing his best work. Job was saying, God, I can't hear you because you seem to be silent. But God was doing his best work in Job's life because sometimes when you can't hear God's voice, you need to trace his hand. Have I got a witness here? God knows how to work in our lives when it seems like he's doing nothing. But God is most active when he seems still. This is not the time that you should say, I'm going to take my own situation in my own hand and try to achieve only what God can do. You've got to let God work it out because there are some things in your life. God wants you to be still and know that he's God. He wants you to understand it was never you that got you this far. It was never you that did what you thought you were doing. It was God all the time working behind the scene for your good. not your ingenuity, not your degree, not your know-how, not your cognitive mind. It was God working it out for your good. That car didn't miss you because you were so skillful or you hit your brakes on time. You don't have that job you got now. You got all the promotions because you were so good. God was working it out. Despite the fact some people didn't want you there, God was working it out. Some people were plotting for you to be gone. God worked it out. For your good. Daily happenings, whether tragic or joyous, is the raw material which God is weaving the design in our lives. Sometimes you got to look at your image and say to them, you about to be my elevation. Have I got a witness here? Because no matter what you do, God can take what you do and work it out for my good. Have I got a witness here? See, God can take a crooked stick and make a straight lick. God does not need the proper situation in order to work everything out for your good. God can take nothing and make something out of it. I wish I had somebody here. It doesn't matter what your enemy throw at you, God can give it to you a different way. Introduce anything to God in the course of life, and order will emerge out of chaos. God can work with nothing. We know it when he made creation. But then he went a step further. He decided to work with dust and make man. Have I got somebody? He worked with Samson's hair and made strength. Give God anything and God can work it out for your good. He is too kind to do anything cruel. Too wise to make a mistake. Every conceivable circumstance that enters your life and mine, God can prosper his plans and further his highest good. How do you know that, Pastor? Come here, Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas on that missionary journey. Bible says Paul had a dream. I need you to go to Macedonia. Well, really think about it. Macedonia was central to all of Europe. So God was being strategic and calling him to Macedonia. But when he got there, he ran into trouble. Let me stop right here. Don't you know sometimes when you're doing God's will, when you get there, you run into trouble. Have I got somebody? And then you say, God, you told me to come here. God, you told me to do this. God, you told me to walk this way. God, you told me to take on this. But when you get where God told you to go, trouble will meet you at the door. Watch what happened. Doing God's business. Have I got somebody? They were doing the business of God. And the Bible says because they messed up the market there in Macedonia, they got thrown into prison. Have I got somebody? But don't you know, baby, even when you're thrown into prison, even when it looks dark, you ought to give God some praise. The Bible says, you ought not have a prayer in your mouth just when things are going right. You ought not have a song in your heart just when things are going right. The Bible says they begin to sing and to pray. And sometimes, baby, you got to sing and pray your way out of some situations in life. It won't be your mind. It won't be your money. You just got to tell God, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If you withdraw yourself from me, where shall I go? Sometimes you just got to get on your knees and tell God, I'm your child. And I know you see what I'm going through right now. And since I'm your child, I need you to do something about it. And the Bible says that the chains fell off. I wish I had a good witness in this house. Hasn't it been in your life sometimes folks tried to lock you up and put you away that you sung and prayed and the chains fell off? What they were trying to put on you came off. Have I got somebody? Soldier woke up.
Man, I need to kill myself. Looks like a mess in here. Bible says, Paul says, do yourself no harm. Sometimes you got to help your enemy out. I wish I had somebody. Do yourself no harm. We're all here. Jumped in there, went down to see where Paul was, and the Bible says he gave his heart to the Lord. Not only did he give his heart, but his whole household was saved. God sometimes works through adverse situation to bring supreme blessings in the house. Yes, he does. Then I see something else in this verse. All things work together for good. God's plan, child of God, is inclusive. Are you with me here? That there's nothing that God can't take and work it out for your good. All things means exactly what it says. Throw it all in there. Your dark days, your good days, your joy, your pain, sunshine, and rain. All things work together for good. Everything in every possible situation is under God's control. Often we can't see it when we're in it. Even bereavement, sickness, disappointment, pain, accident, loss of child, all of it is working together, whether you believe it or not, for your good. We may be willing to admit that life as a whole is subject to God's control. But I stop by to tell you, we hesitate sometimes to admit that everything in your life and my life is subject to every detail, to his loving concern. That means God did not miss every tear that fell from your eye. He's never missed every heartache that you had. He's never missed the frustrations that you were going through. He's never missed when you felt like you couldn't make it. He was right there. I believe I'm talking to somebody now. God knows right now what you're going through. He understands what you're up against right now. And no matter how it's thrown at you, he's working it out for your good. Often we ask, why did you allow it? Has anybody been there? I've been doing what you wanted me to do. Been walking the way you wanted me to walk. I did everything you asked me to do. Why? I believe I'm talking to somebody now. Why did it happen to me? And I see some folk who acting like rascals every day. Raising hell all over the place. Don't mean their wife no good. Don't mean their children no good. Doing their own thing. Why? Did it have to happen to me? We've been there. But the text assesses that God uses every circumstance. For my good. Oh, hallelujah. Because whether you want to admit it or not, you've had some painful circumstances. Some perplexing situations. Some things you said, God, I wish this never happened to me. But God can take what you wish never happened to you and work it out for your good. Sometimes we got to look back and say, God, I thought that was the end, but it was just the beginning. I thought I wasn't going to come out, but you brought me through. I thought it was over, but now I can tell you how I got over, how I made it over, because God brought me out. I need some saints in this house who can say, it may not seem good. At the time, it didn't feel good. It didn't even look good. But he worked it together for my good. If a God can monitor the sparrows that fall to the ground, he can monitor everything in your life. If God can number every hair on your head, he has not missed a detail in your life. The circumstances of a believer's life are ordained. What you say, preacher? It was ordained for Job to lose it all. And God allowed it. Ordained that he might have balls on his body. Sit there and peel his skin off in ashes. Hygiene's become disturbing and fire. Yet it was ordained by God. That God allowed. Deigned that God allowed his wife to tell him to curse God and die. You talk like a foolish woman. The same God that was blessing us is the same God that can take it away. Have I got somebody? I said, God has ordained some dark days in your life. But those dark days will make you better. God has ordained some rough places in your life, but those rough places will make you better. God has ordained some hills in your life, and mama can't help you climb that hill. Daddy can't help you climb that hill. God has ordained some mountains in your life, and you're going to have to tell God, give me the strength to climb. You ain't hearing me now. You done tuned me out now. Your God has ordained some pain in your life. God has ordained some rough times that you say, God, why? But in the end, he's working it out. If God permits it in your life, he has designed it with the wise purpose for your life. You've got to say humbly, I don't know why. I say, you got to say, I don't know why. See, we want to be in control of everything. Figure it all out. Know what's around the corner. You know, have it all mapped out. You know what I mean? You know, we want to make sure we got everything in place. But sometimes God will not allow you to dot the I across the T. Sometimes God will blind you like Paul. You got to say, I walk by faith and not by sight. God's got to lead you around now. You ain't in control of anything now. God's going to have to say, you got to trust me for everything that's going on in your life now. You're not going to be able to figure it out. You're going to have to rely on me. The Spirit of God's going to have to guide you through everything in life. You ever been there? You had enough money, now you don't. You ever been there? That you were in a place, you knew where you were going. Now you don't know what's going on in your life. And now you got to say, walk with me, God. You remember singing that song, walk with me, Jesus, while I'm on this journey. Now God has to walk with you. Every adverse experience, rightly received, got some quotient of good. If I had not went through it, I'd be walking past your pain right now. But since I've gone through it, I can hear what you're saying now. Have I got somebody? If I had not been broken, I'd look over you right now. But since I've been broken, I can hear what you're saying right now. If he had not humbled me, I'd have my nose up right now. Saying I did it all. But since he humbled me, I ain't got nothing to brag on now but the grace of God. Oh, don't get me wrong. I got a degree. I got a little money in the bank, but I got nothing to brag on now. Because I've come this far by the grace of God. Have I got somebody? Every step I had to make, it's been nothing but God's grace. Have I got somebody? Sometimes I didn't know whether I was up or whether I was down. It was just God's grace. And sometimes we don't want to admit it's been like that in my life. And since I walk like that now, before I can walk like it now. I said somebody missed that. Since I trusted God to guide me before, when it get dark, when things are not right, I can trust him. Guide me over. Great Jehovah, pilgrim through this very land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me. Hey, with your powerful hand. Bodily pain, weaknesses, let me know how frail I am. Perplexities reveal I don't have all answers. Financial shortfalls, let me know just how limited I am. Mistakes and fails humble me against being spiritually arrogant. All these things have some good in them, because they allowed me to get connected to God. I'm about through. I got one more. It ain't that long. The final thing about God's plan for a believer is to recognize this. God's plan is harmonious, like an orchestra. Some sounds apart from the band would sound awkward and unusual. What God does, he takes every piece of your life and makes a symphony out of it. Are you with me here? It all works together in a preconceived pattern. The events of life are not unrelated. They just unfold one scene at a time. You cannot predict how the movie is going to end by looking at the first scene. Are you with me here? Because first scene, you know, it might look pretty bad. God has already wrote this script. God has a way of making your drama turn out to your deliverance. Are you with me here? It's like a physician who can skillfully mix medicine. But taking one medicine at a time, it could kill you. But under the skillful hand of a physician, it can make you better and achieve your good. Are you with me? Sometimes we say, how can this be working together for my good? And the answer is, wait until the great physician finish writing your prescription. How many of us can look back and testify what we thought was a disaster in our lives ultimately proved to be a blessing in our lives? How many of us can look back and say how God has brought you over and brought you through. And when you look back, you didn't have nothing then, but now God has blessed you with more than you thought you would ever have. Are you with me here? In times we were experiencing severe trial, we attempted in the middle of our storm to believe that there is an exception to the trial, or the storms we're going through will not end up for our good. God has a way of working everything out. Life has taught us that God hangs a rainbow in the sky after the storm. When you're in the midst of the storm, you really can't see, because we live in the moment a whole lot. But God will take you through a storm. And then after the storm is over, he hangs a rainbow in the sky. Have I got somebody? The storm is passing over. Oh, yes, it is. But in reality, the storm is passing out. See, storms cannot outlast God. God will outlast the storm. And so you got to recognize that God is ultimately in control. You remember the life of Joseph? Joseph's life was one that was overwhelmed with tragedy. Banished from his home, sold in slavery, unjustly put in prison, and literally forgotten there. It was difficult for him to see that these events were working together for good. And often it's difficult for us to see all of the events in our lives working together for good. But in the end, let me give you a testimony. You'll say like Joseph, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for my good. So you got to hold on. You got to trust God. You got to wait out the storm. You got to believe that God is going to come through. If you hold on and trust God, after a while and by and by, God will work it out, everything in your life, for your good.
Set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, it did. I think about the years I spent just passing through. To have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile and take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Like northern stars. God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. That God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. The days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted, till your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same thing. But you never forget all the ones who love you and the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take, but more.